Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to Sabbath Services here in Cincinnati. We're just about right on time here at 2:30. We're glad you're with us. Of course, we got a lot of guests today, so welcome. And those of you listening and watching it on the web, welcome as well. We have one big service here. So if you'd all take your hymnals and stand, we'll begin things with three hymns of praise. Started off by singing hymn number 145. Let's all sing together on hymn number 145, I Sing the Mighty Power of God. Thank you. You sound wonderful. It's a super big blessing to have the choir behind as well. If you'd all turn to number 15, we'll keep things going by singing hymn number 15. We'll sing The Lord's My Shepherd. Very good. Now let's all turn over to hymn 122. We'll sing hymn number 122, Great is the Lord. And after this, Mr. Clay Thornton will come forward to give the opening prayer. But first, number 122.
Of our God, the Father's heart. Eternal Father in heaven, thank you so much for your being our Father. Thank you so much for taking care of us. Thank you that Jesus Christ is your right hand and that he is our shepherd, taking a care over seeing his flock. We're so thankful, Father, to be a part of that flock. We thank you for the understanding that you've given us. We thank you for the truth that is overwhelmingly exciting and filled with hope and promise. Father, we thank you so much for this service. We ask for your guidance on every aspect of it. Thank you for the technical means to be able to share this message with those staying at home and viewing it through their computers and televisions. Thank you so much for that blessing. We ask for everything to go well with all the technical aspects. Thank you for this service now. We ask for your guidance and your blessing on all phases in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. For the sermonette this afternoon, we'll hear from Mr. Jason Nitzberg.
Well, howdy, everyone. If there was a zeitgeist or a spirit of the times that encapsulates all the hot topics of today's United States, I would argue that the spirit is couched in the framework of injustice. Our rights and freedoms are being violated, which is injustice. This person or this system is racist, which is injustice. Even if you think supposed injustice is fake, that means there are false accusations, which is also an injustice. This keeps coming up, and it gets an emotional, dare I say, angry reaction a lot of times. The feelings are very equal opportunity. There is something for everyone to get angry about. Yay! Whew. No, not yay. Man, for Christians, however, we generally try to stay clear from the word angry, you know, in describing ourselves especially, because of its negative connotation with, you know, systematic anger problems. So instead, we say things like we're frustrated, we're maddened, we're annoyed, we're saddened. Because what we're trying to convey is we're still in control of our emotions. We all know an easy way for Satan to lead us down a bad path is to get us all overly emotional. We think irrationally, and we say and do some really horrible things. So we know that's bad. Got it. But what about our rational, calm vexations? The term that religious people use to describe it is righteous indignation. And basically, it's a really tricky form of anger. Turn with me to Luke 9. Luke 9. Righteous indignation is when basically we're angry because we're appalled at something that we perceive to be morally incorrect. And because we bring our sense of morality to our indignation, it's generally argued that it's logical to claim it's an acceptable form of anger. However, if you've been in any kind of long-term close relationship, like those of you that have significant others, or even growing up between teenager and parents, you can be absolutely morally right and frustratingly be wrong at exactly the same time because our approach was wrong, timing, tone, inconsideration, etc. My question is, what manner of spirit is our own righteous indignation? What manner of spirit is our righteous indignation? Here in Luke 9, we have one of the best examples of righteous indignation in action. The heading of Luke 9, specifically in verse 51, will say, a Samaritan village rejects the Savior. So put yourself there. A whole village acts really rudely to Jesus, and then his disciples, James and John, ask him if they can command fire to totally consume and destroy the village. Now, most commentaries paint James and John out to be these overly zealous, emotions gone wild brothers. However, there's another possibility after reading the context specifically of Luke 9 that actually the brothers might have been very rational, very calm, and very logical in their request to Jesus. So let's read it. Luke 9, verse 51. Luke 9, verse 51. Now it came to pass, when the time had come for him, Jesus, to be received up, that he steadfastly set his face to go to Jerusalem, verse 52, and sent messengers before his face. And as they went, they entered a village of the Samaritans to prepare for him. Verse 53, but they did not receive him, as in the city did not receive him, because his face was set for the journey to Jerusalem. Okay, so several things to consider here. One, as you probably remember, hospitality in biblical times was this huge, huge cultural expectation. So to say no vacancy, when obviously all the inns are open, was a rude smack in the face. Okay, number two, we know that Samaritans did not get along with Jews. We know that. So for Jesus' face to be set to Jerusalem, that place that the Samaritans were like, you don't have to go there to worship. You go over here to our temple. So you could see that there is some animosity, or you shouldn't belong here. But Josephus says that the Galilean Jews went to Jerusalem through Samaria every year for the holy days. Every year. So this might not be a, I don't like your kind of thing. It may not be that, but rather a, I don't want anything to do with you in particular, because your messenger has already told me who you are. So if this was a personal attack, then this was a serious injustice. In verse 20, which occurred before this event, Peter identifies Jesus as the Christ of God when Jesus asks, who am I? So now James and John, remembering that, are facing a village that has just personally, purposely rejected the Messiah of the God that they supposedly worship. This could be the most justified moment to be righteously indignant. Verse 54, let's continue. Verse 54, and when his disciples, James and John, saw this, that the town did not receive Jesus, they said, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them just as Elijah did? Okay, so I said it really calmly, right? Was this said in a menacing way, with their firebolt energy growing in their hands? Zzz, Lord, do you want us to command fire to come down from heaven and consume them? Zzz, you know, I mean, was that what happened? Was it like some kind of crazy anime? I mean, they could have, I guess they could have, but I'm not sure if that really considers James and John's amazing story arc in chapter 9's context. It's really super fascinating. I highly recommend reading through the whole chapter. But if you hold your place in verse 54, turn to verse 1 in chapter 9. And Jesus is giving all the disciples basically a promotion. Rather than just being his students, Jesus gives them actual power to heal diseases and authority over demons. Any of you got those power? Like, this is kind of a big deal. They just went from water boys to offensive linemen. Like, this is a big deal. Plus, in verse 3, Jesus sent them out preaching without any provisions. So they had to rely on God and think for themselves because now they were being sent out. Jesus wasn't there. What do I do, Jesus? They had to decide that. So basically, it's you can kind of think of this as a graduation or a coming of age story. So they're still trying to kind of prove themselves. I can do this. And since James and John were part of the big three that saw the transfiguration in verse 29, that's in this chapter too, And then they were arguing about who is the greatest in verse 46. So they saw the transfiguration. They were the ones. They were all arguing about who's the greatest. So as the obvious leaders could kind of be logically come to of the group, they think something should be done about these Samaritans. So look again at verse 54. Lord, do you want us to command fire down? So this is posed as a question, not a command. If you think about irate and overzealous people, they shoot first and ask questions later. James and John here are at least asking a question. Now, granted, they're ready to shoot, but they're asking a question. Also notice that they're using a logical reasoning by using the precedent set by Elijah, a very rational way of approaching a situation. How do I deal with a situation? How have I done it before? Got it. Very rational, rather than just making stuff up as you go. And they didn't just pull Elijah's story out of thin air. Well, I'm just going to be like Elijah. But if you look at verse 8 and verse 19, both show the public thinking Jesus might be the Elijah. So this is kind of in the air. This is all happening in this chapter. Then verse 30 has James and John seeing a vision of Elijah in the transfiguration. Like Elijah keeps coming up. And finally, some commentaries actually suggest that this village might be near where the actual Elijah commanded fire to consume two groups of 50 soldiers. Like they could be in the same vicinity. So knowing all this, there is a possibility, considering the context, that when James and John approach Jesus with their question about nuking this Samaritan town, that they were calm, cool, and resigned to what they believed was the most rational way to deal with this situation. In addition, the situation is easily argued a very justified case of righteous indignation. But what's the bigger deal with righteous indignation is actually what we do with it. That's what makes Jesus's reply to their question to destroy this city so instructive. So let's look at verse 55. Verse 55, Luke 9. And I'm going to read from the New King James Version, which does read different than translations similar to the NIV. So verse 55 says, but Jesus turned and rebuked James and John. And Jesus said, you do not know what manner of spirit you are of. The word spirit here is pneuma. And Thayer's explains that it may be used to describe a breeze or God's power. It's got several definitions. The fifth definition of spirit applies here. This is what Thayer says. Universally, the disposition or influence which fills and governs the soul of anyone. In other words, it's that thing that drives you. Jesus continues here instructing verse 56, for the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. And they went to another village. So Jesus is highlighting the tricky part about being righteously indignant, that if we don't check what manner of spirit that we're actually of, what's actually driving us, we can totally miss what God is trying to achieve. We could accidentally be working against God. The Jameson Fawcett Brown commentary says this, quotes this on this verse, let us never do anything for religion which is contrary to religion. Let me say that again. That's a really good quote. Let us never do anything for religion which is contrary to religion. James and John were trying to right some very serious wrongs. But if they had had their own way in sending fire down from heaven on this village, they would have been working against God's very purpose to save those people. Now, being righteously indignant usually can be summarized as a perspective challenge. It has a tendency to make us into a Sherlock Holmes of sorts, where we find a clue and we bring out our magnifying glass to inspect it. Ah, clue. We get so engrossed in the clue because now we're staring at the proof of injustice magnified 50 times. We're like zoomed in on it. But that closeness breeds a singular vision where we spotlight just a couple of scriptural truths, forgetting the scriptural forest. Jesus's rebuke to James and John here in Luke shows how we check what manner of spirit that we're of. He points out one of God's key missions, which effectively forced James and John to take several steps back away from the magnifying glass to gain some perspective. Oh, verse 56, the Son of Man did not come to destroy men's lives, but to save them. That has a huge implication to our logic, our attitude, and conclusions that we come to. If we have the idea, okay, the Son of Man came to save, just have that, man, Son of Man came to save, in our perspective, then any train of thought that doesn't fit that mission, even though it may be logical, it may be very rational, is likely a manner of spirit that we shouldn't be a part of. So there are a number of God's key missions, you know, these bigger perspective busting types of statements. And I'd heartily encourage everyone to meditate and write down ones that kind of come to you that are kind of in that same vein. A couple of others on my list, for instance, is the second one on my list is we are to be in the world, but not of it. Like, that's a hard thing. A third one, key mission, is mercy triumphs judgment. Like, that's another hard one. Friends, the zeitgeist of our day, at least here in the States, is a mess of real and imagined injustices. Injustices is everywhere. It won't be natural for anyone to actually question our own righteous indignation because we know that we're right. We know that we're rational and that all these verses apply to the other guys. Thank God that we serve a loving Father that shows an irrational amount of mercy to move and shake hearts like ours. What manner of spirit is our righteous indignation?
Thank you, Mr. Nitzberg. Brethren, if you'd all take your hymnals and stand, we'll sing another hymn. This time, let's all sing number 84. We'll all sing together on hymn number 84, Hallelujah, Praise God.
Please be seated.
We'll just go over the announcements now. If you'd all take out the announcement bulletin that you received as you walked in today, we'll just review a few things. The first couple of items on the bulletin relate to the assistance for the Kentucky tornado victims. The first item is over. There are no more donations being accepted at this time. The Drurys have packed up, but they did want to extend their heartfelt gratitude to all of those who donated and provided their assistance in loading. I don't know if any of you saw, there were quite a few things gathered, and so that's really going to help, and it's a tremendous, it's tremendously appreciated, all the assistance and donations. However, if you still would like to help and contribute, the second item on your bulletin indicates where financial donations can be made. Oftentimes, that's a very effective way to do it as well, because then those funds can be dispersed in ways that are most helpful in all the right places. So please give a look at those links if you'd like to contribute financially. Okay, the youth instruction classes are over. We'll skip that one. The next one pertains to an item tonight. Volleyball is going to take place this evening from 6 to 9 at Nothing But Net Sports Complex there, and the address is given there. As always, Dwayne Phelps is the person to contact if you have any questions or need anything. The next one is a help wanted notice that if you can help out with afternoon snacks, serving on the team and, of course, always contributing the food, it would be greatly appreciated. So if you can help out in that way, right now you really only need to help once a month, and that's just for serving and cleaning up the snacks. So they would appreciate a few more volunteers to that end. I know everybody enjoys the snacks, but it does take quite a bit of effort to put together. So if you can help out in that way, it would be very appreciated. And if you can help, please see Laura Peabody. The next couple have been given before, serving senior citizens. So again, the ABC students are putting together a service project to assist senior citizens if they need things done around the house. And so if you're in need of some of those things, please contact Winston Snyder at the email address there in the bulletin. They love to help and they're looking for opportunities, so don't be shy. And the other item that we have spoken of before is the ABC annual fundraiser with the magnetic calendars. So you can read about that there, but the information table has more information on that. The next couple items are a couple save the dates. The first concerns the ABC charity auction coming up on March 20th, which is a few months away yet, but they'd like you to get it on your calendars so that you can make time for that. It's going to happen on March 20th, 2022. So make a note of that date. And then also, if you're interested in attending the ABC Continuing Education, that's going to happen later in the month of May. So make a note there of the details. Cards of encouragement for brethren. This is also a recurring thing, but it really is something to highlight and remember that if you can take the time to sign the cards in the information table each week, those cards do mean a lot to those who receive them. They are incredibly helpful, and it just takes a few minutes to go and read Of course, you can add those folks to prayer lists if you're not already aware of some of those situations. And so it's a very beneficial way to serve. So please do take time to do that. There's a note about COVID-19 funeral assistance. If that concerns you, there's details there. There's also another note, sort of a regular weekly item about praying for the gospel to have free course, which, of course, should be, one of our main areas of prayer as we pray to God that his gospel can go out into this world that needs it now more than ever. But there's so many different situations in different countries. And so in the bulletin here, we've got a situation in Myanmar that's worth reading and praying about. So please pay attention to that. The Inside United podcast also that concerns the recent Kentucky tornadoes. And so if you're interested to hear from Doug Collison, he talks with Mr. Kubik about the things that happened out in their area relating to the tornadoes. And then finally, the Beyond Today schedule, which is always there, just to make a note of what's coming up there on Beyond Today. Okay, that's all the announcements I was given. So we do have the sermon this afternoon, and it'll be brought to us by the President of the United Church of God, Mr. Victor Kubik. But first, we have the privilege of hearing special music from the ABC 2021-22 Chorale. They'll be singing two selections. The first is called God So Loved the World by Larry Shackley. It's based on John 3:16-17. And 1 John 3, verse 1. It'll be accompanied by Tim Claudis on the piano and directed by Ken Shoemaker. And the second song will be Thanksgiving Joy by Joseph M. Martin. The choir will sing and accompanied by Tim Claudis on piano again and directed by Chad Browning. So following the choir then, we'll hear the sermon of the afternoon from Mr. Kubik. Thank you.
rejoice again. I say rejoice.
Wasn't that music beautiful? I just not only love the music, but love the class. This has been, to me, the high point of the day is when I teach my class at 1:30 on Monday, Wednesdays, and Fridays. This particular class has really grown on me. I just really appreciate them very much. And to see them all singing here, I was just kind of just thinking about my class and enjoy just looking at them. Very, very fine class. Just really developed probably a closer relationship than with others. With them. So thank you very much for the very beautiful music. Just like to comment about the assistance for tornado victims in Western Kentucky and also other places. I'd like to commend the work that's been done by the people here. I know that the Drurys, the Evanses, the Creeches, and others have been collecting here, and they are on their way to deliver them to those areas. I've been in contact with our elders, Doug Collison in Paducah, and I have a special feeling for that because I was pastor in Paducah, Kentucky for 7 years and had traveled to Mayfield where the candle factory collapsed and killed a lot of people. So it's very, very involved with that area. And one of the people that was three blocks away in the church were people that were already there in Paducah 45 years ago when I was a pastor. That's a long, long time ago. And they were safe, and they were they lived only three blocks away from the candle factory, and just had a broken window. That's all they had. But they had a tree that fell on their house, and literally the next day or so, the VA came, cut up the tree, and hauled it off. So our brethren have been protected and saved. I'm not sure about how much damage is in the Bowling Green area, but they're taking this shipment, this load of water and other needed items, down to Kentucky this afternoon, this evening. You might want to listen to the podcast that I made with Doug Collison just a few days after that. After the tornado, he had gone down there twice to see what was there. In fact, he had to go through the worst of the area just to get to the members' home, to Craig and Carolyn Evans' home. He said you could not believe, he never saw anything quite like that. Everything was so flattened and destroyed. It looks like Hiroshima from a drone shot. It looks just totally, everything is destroyed. And we've been talking about that. He commented about some personal stories about what he witnessed personally. And the most touching of all was he was on the highway, traffic just creeping along very slowly, trying to get around all the rubble. And here's one car meeting another car. And they were people who hadn't seen each other, didn't know if they were alive or not, that pulled out of their, that came out of the wreckage. And the two women just jumped out of the cars and hugged each other for 10 minutes. He says, nobody, didn't bother anybody in the traffic because they were so happy to see these people be reunited. So there are many, many good stories of bravery, people pulling together. If only people could be like this in peacetime when things are going well. But in hard times like this, people do pull together. We have put up a fundraiser for both Good Works is collecting money and Life Nets is collecting money. And Life Nets in the first day and a half collected over $6,000. And we will be using it. I'm working with Greg Drury on the proper best way to dispense it, along with Doug Collison, because a lot of money comes in usually right after a tragedy. It comes in right away. I mean, you don't know what to do with all the money. But if we were to ask in 4 or 5 months that we need to have a special fund for tornado victims, you know, people forget, and that enthusiasm isn't there. So a lot of times there are expenses that need to be covered down the road, things that aren't known. Some of them are like insurance, for example, can cover repairing a roof or a home, but they only pay 80% or they only pay so much, and there's still a lot of expenses that have to be covered. So we want to be able to cover those types of expenses down the road. Typically, we found that it takes up to a year to be able to determine exactly all the financial needs like that. But this tornado was huge, and it was terrible and powerful. What can we give God that he doesn't already have? What could we give to God who has everything? He owns the entire universe. He created it. He's omniscient, omnipresent, omnipotent. He's omni-everything. God is huge. And who are we? What could we give him? We're aware of him, but what can we give him? So if you were to give him a gift, what would it be? What do you think that he actually would like from you? Because obviously he doesn't need material possessions. He already owns everything. Anything we would offer would just be very, very trivial. He doesn't need any advice from us. He doesn't need any scientific knowledge from us. Tell him, hey, God, I discovered E equals MC squared. He says, okay, wonderful. Here, I'll show you some formulas. The universe is so complex and wonderful and so tuned in life here that there's nothing that we could really advise him on. There is something, however, that's meaningful that we could give God that he doesn't already have. And what could that possibly be? Something that God does not have and something that God wants from you right now. In the beginning, man was created in God's image and likeness. We were given characteristics not given to any other form of life. We were made in God's image. That means in his appearance, attributes, characteristics such as the ability to think, plan, make decisions, and be creative. There are many other forms of life that come nowhere near to these functions, the cognitive functions. You don't have mammals, monkeys, gorillas, or anything leaving a legacy behind them. Beavers who build dams don't leave behind a university how to build dams. They just, one generation after another, just instinctively does what they have been programmed to do from creation. But in God's creation and his new creation of us, he requires us to participate in a creation module, I'll call it, that requires our input and our participation. As he's creating us in his image and likeness, and obviously he's part of his family because we look like him and we're part of him, he calls us sons and daughters, but he requires our input. He kind of stops everything and says, okay, input required by participant. It is something that God cannot create by himself. Oh, he could create it, but it really wouldn't be fulfilling the purpose that he would want it to fulfill. And so that one ingredient is the one that I want to describe in my sermon today. Actually, those were the last words of Jason Nisberg. He actually fed right into my sermon by the last line of his sermon. That ingredient that God is looking for in us, I'll explain it in detail, is our heart. Oh, God, here's another heart sermon. Now, God does want our heart, but what does that all mean? I don't think we really fully realize just how powerfully and ubiquitously the word heart is used in the Bible. It comes out in 800, it's used 826 times. 826 times. There's just a lot said about the heart. While similar words that may overlap some with heart, like mind or minds, are only used 111 times. So the word heart is the word that's used both in the Old Testament as the Hebrew word leb, and in the New Testament as cardia, heart, cardiologist, heart. And also the word spirit is used overlapping some of the heart. But heart has its own distinctive definition. And that's what I'll be focusing on in my sermon today. Unger's Bible Dictionary has a comprehensive definition of the biblical usage of heart, supported by many scriptures. As I said, there's 826 references to heart, and there are quite a few different ways and angles and views of how we can do a heart. Now, I'll cover some of the high points of that, but obviously I can't cover them all in all the passages. But I will make a handout available online if you come up afterwards and ask me about it, then I'll advertise it too, from Unger's Bible Dictionary. Or if you do have Unger's Bible Dictionary, which I think that many of you might, as a reference, one of the best references for the Bible that there is, you could go under the heading of heart. The heart is described as the innermost center of the natural condition of man. It's the heart of things. Number one, it's the center of bodily life. This is the physical heart. I'll go over this very quickly. Our heart pumps blood. Our heart has many functions that it oversees in the functioning of our bodies. When the heart stops, you no longer live. It is the reservoir for eating, drinking, and the strengthening of the body. It becomes the whole man, physical man. Then the heart is also, number two, the center of the rational, spiritual nature of man. This is the part that we want to focus on. The rational, spiritual nature of man, which is not there in animal life, unless it's by instinct. Where we are aware of ourselves, we are self-aware, as animals usually are not self-aware. Or they may be defensive, but they're not aware of their grandma and grandma, and they're not looking to the future necessarily. They exist because they've been programmed, created that way to do what they're doing. Thus, when a man determines upon anything, he's called to presume in his heart to do so. Presume in his heart to do so. When he is strongly determined, he stands firm in his heart. He can do what he's doing gladly, willingly, and of a set purpose, and it's done with obedience from the heart. Again, scriptural references are in the handout. The heart is the seat of love and of hatred. Love proceeds from our heart. I love you. I love you, Bev. That's from my heart, and that's not from my hand, although it's not from my toes. It's from my heart. We love from the heart. But it's also the seat of hatred. When you hate somebody, when your hatred comes to you, it's from the heart. The heart is the center of thought and conception. The heart speaks of, in Deuteronomy 29:4, it knows, the heart knows. The heart is also the center of feelings and affections, of joy. Number three, the heart is the center of moral life. This is our relationship with God and the way we relate to Him by certain rules. So that all moral conditions, from the highest love of God to down to the self-defying pride, is all in within moral life as part of the heart. They're concentrated in the heart as the innermost life circle of humanity. The heart is the laboratory and origin of all that is good and evil in thoughts. Those thoughts, they are manufactured in this little factory laboratory called the heart, and translated into words and deeds. They are the rendezvous of evil lusts and passions that come from the heart. It's a place where God's natural law is written in us. It's in our heart. The law is written in our heart. It is the seat of conscience, where you feel one way or another very strongly. That's part of your heart. There is so much connected right there in that heart. It is the dwelling place of Christ in us. It's also where the Holy Spirit is found, where the Holy Spirit comes into our heart. It is the center of the entire man and the very heart of man's impulse. So that is how heart is defined in the usage in 826 places in both Hebrew and Greek. And the definition for both languages is similar. One of the first historic references to a dysfunctional heart is listed in Ezekiel, 28 in verse 17. So much of the Bible speaks about dysfunctional heart and also moving on towards a functional heart, a whole heart. This starts in pre-Adamic times, when we have an event occur in Exodus chapter 28 and verse 14. Ezekiel 28 and verse 14. This goes back to way before Adam, before the creation of man, where the word heart appears historically first. You were the anointed cherub, verse 14 of Ezekiel 28, who covers, I established you, God speaking here. You were on the holy mountain of God. You walked back and forth in the midst of the fiery stones. Verse 15, you were perfect in your ways from the day that you were created. You were perfect until iniquity was found in you. Here's the problem. And here's where heart problems really began. And this event really led to the whole process of redemption in the creation of man, leading to the redemption through Jesus Christ and to where we come right now. Because Lucifer was perfect in all his ways, and yet he had iniquity that was found in him. Verse 17, and what was that first iniquity? Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. This is the first reference to sin. This is the first sin, pride. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. So while he was perfect, he was vulnerable. That vulnerability led to his heart being lifted up and him becoming the god of this world, one who's created a huge amount of damage. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty. You corrupted your wisdom. See, he was perfect. But all of a sudden, all the things that he knew and put together very well in God's way and so forth was corrupted for the sake of your splendor. You abused all the good things that God had done because of your pride. So God said, I cast you to the ground. He was cast down to this earth. I laid you before kings that they might gaze at you. So from this time forward, from Ezekiel 28, God has had a plan of redeeming, of creating mankind, and to where he will take care of Lucifer, but will use what happened there in the refining of man to become wholehearted in being part of the family of God. Now let's take a look at the first human use of heart in the Bible. First human use of heart in the Bible. This is after the creation in Genesis chapter 6 and verse 5. Genesis chapter 6 and verse 5. After Adam and Eve were expelled from the Garden of Eden, there were many generations until the time of the flood. In fact, there were 1,600 years that passed. I mean, almost one-fourth of the time of mankind's history was between creation and the flood. Verse 5, then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth. It was really going in a very bad way. And that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth. He was grieved by this response in his heart. People think that maybe that's figurative, that, well, God is grieved. I mean, God was kind of unhappy. You know, God is very personal with us. When it says that God grieves, you know, when we have grieved, when we're sad about something, you know, we really feel badly about it. God, in the same way, felt badly about what was happening with mankind, that his heart was going in the direction of evil. And it was so evil that God had to do the great reset. This is the first reset of civilization, where he had Noah build the ark. He was a preacher of righteousness and preached for decades and decades, almost 100 years. And only he and his family survived the flood. This is how corrupt and evil civilization had become. Well, after the flood, history wasn't too much better. Tower of Babel was just a few generations after that, where mankind still didn't really get it. The heart was darkened. Sodom and Gomorrah, one event after another. Human history has not been good. And when we come to our right time right now, historically, what is the heart of man right now? What is the heart of society? What is the heart of Russia and its leaders, of China, of the United States, of Europe, of leadership? Is there any righteousness? Is there any righteous king out there? Jeremiah writes, Jeremiah was a very frustrated prophet because he was one who really, really fell. Jeremiah 17, verse 9. Jeremiah 17, verse 9, where he describes a summary of what the heart is. Jeremiah 17, verse 9. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, and who can know it? Jeremiah had a long ministry that was very frustrating as he tried to warn, he tried to teach, he tried to connect with leadership of his time. And the net result was really nothing. The nation of Israel, of Judah, was taken into captivity in Babylon. In Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12, the Apostle Paul makes a reference to heart and what the Word of God does to illuminate the heart. Hebrews chapter 4 and verse 12. For the word of God, this is Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, for the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions or the motives of the heart. So we have the heart, which has its problems. But we have the Word of God that is sharper than any two-edged sword that really understands where that has come from and what we need to be doing about it. He knows our heart. No creature is hidden from his sight. God sees everything. God is knowing what's in your mind. He knows what you're thinking. He knows how you present yourself. He knows what's down deep. Nothing is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give account. Now, you may not know the Bible, but the Bible knows you. The Bible knows everything about you. It knows your motives. It knows how you work. It knows how you hide things. It knows the secret things of your life. As in Psalm 44, verse 21, just quickly here, he knows the secrets of the heart, what's in you. So you could present an image outside. All of us do. We've been covering this so much now in 1 John, in our general epistles. You know, we appear one way, but we all sin. We all have things that we do think and say that are wrong and need to ask God's forgiveness for them. I'd like to tell you a story about a school teacher in one of the congregations that I was pastor of. The school teachers in the summertime had a retreat where the teachers from a larger area went to a camping area, a retreat area, to get to know each other better and have a few exercises to learn certain things. So they had a few get acquainted exercises, and he said this one exercise was unbelievable. They wanted to discover what was in each other's hearts and thoughts through a series of anonymous exercises. First of all, they did something all together, men, women. The one thing that they did here was they all went out on the lake in canoes, had a good time. And then they had gotten together, and then they were to say something about another person anonymously on a slip of paper and put it into a hat, what they thought about that person or what some of their ideas were or how they felt about others. But nobody would know who said it. He said that they picked out the pieces of paper from the hat or box and read what was there. And he said, you would not believe how many evil things were there. Nice people, and they were saying things that were lustful. There were things that were angry, things that were jealous, envious. These things that are in a person's heart about one another. And the exercise was to peel onion skin layers away from what we appear like to others and get down deeper to the real core of what we are. And he said it really wasn't, he said, I want to get out of there. He says, I didn't want to find out about others. I didn't want to find out about myself, about what's in my heart. I wanted to get off of this. There were vain thoughts, lustful thoughts, silly delusions that people came up with, things that they wouldn't say to one another, but they could publicly admit or privately admit. This teacher said, I didn't want to get anywhere deeper into the core because I don't like what I see in others and in myself. But Jesus Christ mentioned this when he was talking to the Pharisees in Matthew chapter 15. Matthew chapter 15 and verse 19. I always quote and go through this passage with those who I counsel for baptism, because this describes the natural human mind, the natural human heart. Matthew chapter 15 and verse 19, Jesus Christ is responding to a complaint by the Pharisees that the disciples in Christ were eating with unwashed hands. And Christ said, you are defiling yourselves. And Christ said that, no, what defiles a person is not what goes into that person, a little bit of dirt, maybe, possibly, but what defiles a person that comes out of the man. And so here's what he says comes out of the person. Verse 19, for out of the heart, out of the cardia, Jesus Christ said, he talks about general humanity, proceed, here's what proceeds out of mankind, evil thoughts, murders, adulteries, fornications, sounds like the script to many of our movies, thefts, false witness, blasphemies. I mean, it's a list of evil things, one after another. You know, why do people like to watch sex and violence? It's right there. Because that's what people are. They relate to that. They find that entertaining. Proceed all these evil things. And I tell our people who are baptized, and also when I was baptized, the pastor who counseled me 3 times before I was baptized, he wanted me to admit that I had these things in me. that I needed to repent of them, that I needed to be cleansed of this way of thinking. I needed the Spirit of God. That's why the Spirit of God is given, to cleanse us of what we are in our inner cores. As we take away the vain show, take another onion skin layer off of some of our motives and down to what we are. Because Christ said, this is what appears, this is what proceeds out of the heart of men. Then Jesus also had another incident with Pharisees. The strongest conflicts that he had were always with the religious people, not necessarily with the government people, but with the religious people. Pharisees in chapter 12 of Matthew were accusing Jesus of casting out demons by the chief of demons, Beelzebub. This was not only insulting, but this was just totally untrue, because Jesus Christ did cast out demons, but the Pharisees found an evil motive for that. Christ responds, verse 34, "Brood of vipers, how can you, being evil, speak good things?" He just basically told the Pharisees, you know, you say those ugly things, you're making those vile accusations because you're evil. So naturally, you're not going to be saying good things, you're going to be saying evil things. And then he says, "For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks." Out of the abundance of what's in your heart, you ultimately will be saying those things. You can only hold evil and anger and resentment and ill temper and moodiness so long inside of you, because out of the abundance of the heart, what's in there ultimately is going to come out. It all comes out eventually. I'd like now to turn to an Old Testament example. I've said some pretty raw things about human nature as we see it right now, but God is working with the heart of men. Because when we make the right choices, and when we move towards a heart that is like God's, and move to giving our heart to the Lord, so to speak, he wants a certain heart. He doesn't want just any old heart. He wants a clean heart to be given to him. I'd like you to turn with me to 1 Samuel chapter 16. Because this is a story of heart, one of the classic stories about how God looks and judges people. And this is from the Old Testament. This was a process of selecting the second king in Israel's monarchy. The first king was Saul, who failed miserably. And partially it was because the people didn't look upon what he was like. He was, first of all, God wasn't necessarily wanting the people to have a monarchy, but the people wanted a monarchy. They wanted a king, like the nations around them had kings. And Saul was just a man who fit the bill. He was tall, he was charismatic, he was cool, he was moved around real well, he was bold and bad. But he didn't listen to God. He compromised. So he was removed from his position, even though he was still living. And God said, I'm going to choose another king through the judge of that time, who was called Samuel. And the story is related in 1 Samuel chapter 16 and verse 1. So here's the selection process of the second king of Israel. The Lord said to Samuel, verse 1, "How long will you grieve over Saul, since I have rejected him from being king over Israel?" It was a big event. I mean, the first king came into power, and then he really messed up. And even if a person messes up, people are still, "Well, he was our king. You know, how could this be?" Even though he had been moody, even though he had gone to a witch, even though he didn't obey God's commands, and even though he did just one, his whole history is just of being a very, very bad king. He says, "Samuel, fill your horn with oil." That was a sign, that was a way that a new king was anointed, by pouring oil on him. "I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, for I have provided for myself a king among his sons." So this was a new king was going to be chosen from Jesse, who was from Bethlehem, and he had seven sons. We come down to verse 6. And the selection process is ongoing here. "When they came, he looked on Eliab, Samuel looked upon Eliab and thought, surely, he looked upon the first son, they're all gathered there, and they're going to make a selection from one of them. And so Jesse presents his sons. Hey, here are my boys, look at them. Look how wonderful they are. I'm so honored to have my son be one of the candidates, my sons as candidates to become the next king of Israel. So he first went to Eliab and thought, surely the Lord's anointed is before him. But the Lord, verse 7, said to Samuel, do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature. This was exactly the problem with Saul, the first king. That's all the people saw, or that's what they looked upon. He was a good speaker. He was a person that was dressed well. He was handsome, and he was a head taller than anybody else. Hey, that's our man. That's our king. Lord said to Samuel, do not look at his appearance, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as a man sees. He says, make sure that you judge as God judges. Man looks on the outward appearance, but what does God look at? The Lord looks on the heart. That's the test for the character of the person, of who God wants. Well, okay, the first one was rejected because he didn't meet the qualifications there, and God said, nope, I don't want him. Then Jesse called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. So he kind of walked through, perhaps give an introductory speech, whatever was done. And he said, Samuel said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. Nope, this is not the one. Then Jesse made Shammah pass by. And Samuel said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. Somehow God was communicating with Samuel. And Jesse, verse 10, made 7 of his sons pass before Samuel. So 7 passed, and Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen these. Hey, none of these fit the bill. Then verse 11, then Samuel said to Jesse, are all your sons here? I mean, is this all of them? And he said, well, there remains yet the youngest. But behold, he is keeping the sheep. Somebody had to wash the sheep out in the pasture. And obviously he would not be considered because he was the youngest. He had 7 brothers above him. There were 8 sons altogether. I said 7. He said, somebody had to wash the sheep, tend the sheep out there. He was too young. And Samuel said to Jesse, send and get him, for we will not sit down till he comes here. Because God already said it's got to be one of Jesse's sons, and 7 of them disqualified. So it's kind of tightening up here as to how this is going to work out. And he sent and brought him in. Now he was ruddy and had beautiful eyes and was handsome. Okay, that's okay too, but he was also very young. And the Lord said, okay, this is the one. Arise, anoint him, for this is he. He's our man. He's going to be the next king of Israel. Then Samuel took the horn of oil and anointed him. That was by pouring this horn of oil over his head in the midst of the brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David from that day forward. So the decision, the criteria was, what was David's heart like? Of course, we could give a series of sermons about the heart of David. David certainly wasn't a perfect person. He had committed sins. But also he was a person who asked forgiveness. He obeyed God. He loved God. He loved God's instructions and laws. A statement is made in Acts 13:22 about David. In fact, a little more is said, just in a little phrase, about what it was about David that made him this way. But this is a sermon that Paul was preaching near Antioch. And when he had removed him, Saul, he raised up David as king, to whom also he gave testimony and said, I have found David, the son of Jesse, a man after my own heart, who will do all my will. The quality of David was he had the nature of God, God's nature kind of built into him, but also he would do what God said. He would do all my will. He's one that prayed certainly every day, as Jesus has commanded us, your will be done. He wanted to do those things that filled God. And if he made a mistake, he says, God, forgive me. God, forgive me for what I am. So what we had here is God making certain that the next king of Israel, and of course many other kings after this were more like Saul, but he wanted an example of someone who followed, obeyed God, and would be righteous. There's various instructions that are given to us about the heart in the New Testament. Much is said. I said the heart is this complex part of our body that's connected with the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the physical spirit, the spirit in man, that has the ability to make decisions, has the ability to relate to God and relate to one another. And when Jesus Christ gave his first recorded sermon, and a lot of it had to do with the kingdom of God, he gave certain basic attitudes that we all need to consider strongly as we prepare for the kingdom of God. Matthew chapter 5 and verse 3, this is the Sermon on the Mount, the famous Sermon on the Mount. First of all, he says in Matthew 5, verse 3, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn, verse 4. Blessed are the people who think little of themselves, who are small in their own eyes. People of humility. Blessed are the meek, verse 5. Blessed are the teachable. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. They want to be righteous. They're not trying to find ways to get as close as they could to evil. But they hunger and thirst for what's righteous, for they shall be filled. Blessed are the merciful, which is not the case in Saul and many other kings. But verse 8 is the one I want to focus on. Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Pure in heart. What you have on the outside of what people see on the outside when you talk to them is transparent, it's pure to their very inner being. Blessed are the pure in heart. That is one of the characteristics, qualifications, you might say, of a person who will see God and be in God's kingdom. That's what I'm talking about this subject here. It's important that you assess your heart of what's there. Is what's on the outside and how you relate to God, but also how you relate to one another, is what's on the inside? Or are there two different people? Or maybe even three different people? Are you deceitful? Are you wicked? Are you thinking wrong thoughts? Are you envious? Are you jealous? One term, I remember in Ambassador College when I went there, human nature was described with four words. Mr. Dean probably knows. Vanity, jealousy, lust, and greed. That's what people are. Vanity, jealousy, lust, and greed. We kept walking around that way all the time, repeating that over and over again, because that's what we were. The human mind is desperately wicked. With the cleansing of Jesus Christ of our sins by his blood, and by our baptism with water and receiving the Holy Spirit, we start doing some cleaning, hosing down of what our heart is. Is that an ongoing process? Or do we kind of neglect it? Because if you neglect it, the old will come back. It's a maintenance work of continually praying and cleansing and saying, God, forgive me my sins, forgive me for making mistakes, forgive me for whatever, you know, we do in our lives, whether it's at work or whether it's at home or whether it's with other people, forgive us our sins. Then we become pure, for they shall see God. Proverbs chapter 4, verse 27. I'll just quickly read this. I like this verse. Guard your heart, or keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it springs the issues of life. Protect your heart. Guard your heart. In the paraphrased translation, it's translated, guard your affections, your feelings, your passions. Guard them. For out of them is the wellspring of life. Matthew 13. And this is the chapter which has seven of Christ's parables. For the hearts of the people, this is Jesus Christ when he's going through the parables and explaining why people didn't get them, and he has to explain them to his disciples first. And what had happened here, and he describes it, Matthew 13, verse 15, the hearts of this people have grown dull. That could happen to us too. If we don't continually stay sharp, continually ask God to forgive us our sins through the blood of Jesus Christ, to wash away through baptism and cleanse what we are, we can become dull of hearing, we can become rusty, we can become unable to really be the kind of pure heart that God requires. The hearts of this people have grown dull. Their ears are hard of hearing, and their eyes have they closed. We need to be very careful that we never get to this point, that we begin to shut out those things that were clear at one time, things that were very exciting, to where we just drift and drift and drift and have a hard time even coming back, where they don't even seem to be important anymore. And so he gave these parables for them. At that time, the people didn't understand them, but he gave them to his disciples. Deuteronomy chapter 6. The passage that we often read about loving God and loving mankind, and this is part of it, the two great commands. Deuteronomy chapter 6 and verse 5. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. This is how God is advising and teaching the people of Israel in, you might say, in theory of how they were to be. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. But previously, in a chapter before, he had given them the Ten Commandments all over again. This is Deuteronomy, the giving again of the law. Repetition of the law. Verse 29, where he gives the law again, the Ten Commandments, but then laments that there was a problem, there was a systemic problem with the people. And what was that problem? Verse 29 of Deuteronomy 5, oh, that they had such a heart in them, that they would fear me and always keep all my commandments, that it might be well with them and with their children forever. He says, God, I really wish they had the right heart. So at this point now, as we come in what I'm talking about, God has created mankind. He has not given him everything there quite to be whole. He's created him in his image, his likeness, and given a lot of characteristics to him. But there's a missing dimension. And he's revealing knowledge of that missing dimension to people at various points in history. He has done that with you and me as we have come to repentance and baptism and having that new heart be given to us to be able to love God with all of our heart and mind and strength. But the people there did not have that tool. They did not have that availability. I wish that there was such a heart in them. But God is not going to forsake them. He will be with them, and he will give them the tools that they need. A new heart will be given to Israel, and this flaw will be remedied. It's not God's fault. It's just that God wants to, when he delivers that tool to us, he wants us to make the decision, free will decision, to follow him and obey him from our heart. If God was to just make us do those things and be perfect, we would be like Lucifer, who was perfect in all his ways, beautiful. But there was something wrong, a flaw in his character, to where he became very aware of himself and wanted to dethrone God, became the originator of evil. It's quite a study. I think about these subjects very often. Verse Ezekiel chapter 11 and verse 19, a prophecy of the future. All prophecies, of course, of the future. Ezekiel chapter 11, verse 19, he talks about what will be given to Israel. Then I will give them one heart, and I will put a new spirit within them, and take the stony heart out of their flesh, and give them a heart of flesh. The problem is that the stony heart is a result of people not making the choices that they should, and of course, no availability of the Holy Spirit. But God will give them a heart which will have a new spirit, and that is the Holy Spirit, and take out the stony heart of their flesh and give them a heart of flesh. Right now, we are a microcosm of the kingdom of God. We are the kingdom of God in embryo right here. We're growing because we have the Holy Spirit of God. We're showing God what it's like to have that spirit and grow by it, to make changes, to overcome. Ezekiel 18, since we're right there, Ezekiel, turn over a few more chapters. Ezekiel 18 and verse 30. Therefore I will judge you, O house of Israel, everyone according to his ways, says the Lord God. Repent and turn from all your transgressions, so that iniquity will not be your ruin. The story and the subject of repentance is one that was paramount in the Old Testament. And in the New Testament, what did Jesus Christ say? Repent and believe the gospel. What did the Apostle Peter say on the day of Pentecost? Repent and be baptized. And that's what he's telling, prophesying to Ezekiel here in chapter 18. Repent and turn from all your transgressions, so that iniquity will not be your ruin. When you receive the Holy Spirit of God, it becomes very clear what's good and evil. And you see the outcome of each. We don't have the Holy Spirit, we can get dragged back into the world. The world looks, we had just this study here in 1 John chapter 2 and verse 15 with ABC about the world. Love not the world and all the things that are in it. Its philosophies, its ways that are toxic. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, the pride of life. When we receive the Holy Spirit of God, we clearly see what those things are. We clearly see the outcomes of those things, and we want God's way. Verse 31, Ezekiel 18. Cast away from you all the transgressions which you have committed, and get yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. For why should you die, O house of Israel? God is creating a new heart in all of us right now. It comes through repentance. It comes through good habits. It comes through a way of life. It comes from the transformation of a person. Even though the word heart isn't mentioned in Romans chapter 12, Romans chapter 12 and verse 1 and 2, the Apostle Paul speaks about the new person in Christ. Romans chapter 12. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Again, this is mind, which is not necessarily heart, but it's similar. It's a synonym, somewhat close, but not fully. It's a different Greek word, nous. That you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. That's our purpose in life, is to be able to understand this. God is wanting us to fortify ourselves, to be immunized, to be, hate to use the word vaccinated, but for us to be prepared against all the evil germs of worldliness around us. Here's how David responded to God, Psalm 119. You see why David was a man after God's own heart. From the very beginning, he was chosen by God, but also throughout his life, he expressed joy in his expressions, such as Psalm 119 in verse 1. Psalm 119, verse 1. Blessed are the undefiled in the way who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep his testimonies and who seek him with the whole heart. Nothing held back. God, I want you. I want you. I want a personal relationship with you. I'm opening myself up to you to cleanse me, as David said, purge me with hyssop. It's kind of a weed that grows, not a weed, but it's a plant that, like a little broomstick, it could be made from it. It was dipped into blood, and the high priest went around with sprinkled the mercy seat. Those who seek him with the whole heart. Is that what we do when we pray? God, I want to come close to you. I want to understand you. I want to have full understanding of your way. Then he says in verse 10, with my whole heart I have sought you. Oh, let me not wander from your commandments. The whole Psalm 119, the longest one of the Psalms of David, has the word law, commandments, statute, or something in every one of the verses. David upholds God's way, God's commandments, God's will. David was not afraid to say, I love you, God. I'm seeking you with all my heart. I remember this innocence, and I hope my son doesn't hear this sermon here today. I remember my son was a little boy, and I gave a sermon similar to this about loving God. I remember after the sermon, we came home. Daddy, I love God. I just felt so warmed by it. He was just a little boy, but it was so innocent. That's the way God wants us to come to him. God, I love you. My heart is open to you. God cannot robotically create a clean heart. That's a process that involves user input, let's put it that way. God opens the door and said, now I need to have response from you. I've created you in my image. You look like me. You have characteristics, cognitive abilities, creativity. Some of you can sing, some of you can paint, some of you can do other things. But here's a step where I want your involvement, your hands-on. I want a response from you. Until I get that, you're not fully created. You're still in the process of being created. And that is to have that clean heart that we've been talking about here in this sermon. The creation step has to be concluded by your willingness to have a clean heart before God. It's of your free will. It's of your choice. It is not something that God did for you. God wants us to love him because we want to. And when we have the choice of loving him or not loving him, if we had no choice, then do we really love him? We're just programmed as robots. But we have the choice of, and that's why we have the choices. Choose, I set before you good and evil. God could have made us robots, could have made us more like the angels, but he did not. Choose between good and evil of free will. And you do it because you want to, not because you have to, or because you fear not to do that, or because you have no choice. He wants you to do it from your whole heart. We show that by our thanksgiving for all the things that God has done for us. I go back and look at my life and say, God, thank you for rescuing me here. Thank you for intervening in my life here. I'm so thankful. I'm so thankful to God for all the people that I work with. I'm so thankful to God for being the president of the United Church of God. I'm just so very, very thankful and very grateful for the many wonderful blessings that I've had, how God has healed me and has carried me. I express that gratitude in prayers and in the way, hopefully, that I treat other people around me. We continually seek God's help in changing our heart, because if you don't continually stay in this maintenance mode, it can go cold, hard, go astray, or become dormant. We find ourselves, when we have our heart right with God, we're enthusiastic and zealous about the mission of the church and are excited to be a Christian. We say, I'm thankful that I'm called now. I'm not just dragging around. I'm very thankful to being a Christian. So what can we give God? what is the most meaningful input for his creation to us at this point is giving our heart to him in the way that we have described this afternoon. God only wants our heart. Not only does he want our heart, he wants a clean and pure heart. Now I'll conclude by reading Psalm 51, verses 10 through 12. Psalm 51, verse 10, create in me a clean heart. God, help me make a clean heart. It's my choice, but help me with it. And renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. I mean, he had all the elements there. The Holy Spirit was with David in the Old Testament. He understood that he had to have a clean heart. Now, while we may repent and ask for maintenance and not for the sins that David had, certainly this could apply to many, many other issues. Create in me a clean heart. Wipe away the jealousy. Wipe away the envy. Wipe away the lust and the vanity, putting myself forward. And don't take your Holy Spirit from me. In fact, add to your Holy Spirit. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, verse 12, and uphold me by your generous spirit.
Thank you, Mr. Kubik. Brethren, if you'd all take your hymnals and stand, we'll sing one final hymn as we conclude services. Let's all stand and sing hymn number 152. We'll sing Go Into the World, number 152, and after this, Mr. Zach Williams will ask God's dismissal with the closing prayer. But first, number 152.
Hallowed and holy Father, great eternal God who lives, thank you for the life that you've given us and the heart that you put in us. Thank you, Father, for the truth and the words of freedom which you've given to our hearts. Thank you, God, for this family that you put together and that you're building for eternity. Thank you for your eternal perspective which you put in our heart so that we don't have to lose focus when things get dark. We love you, great Father. Thank you again for the instruction. Thank you for this restful Sabbath. and the time we have together this evening as family. We love you. We love our King. We thank you and we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.